So in today's session, right, we're going to talk about node packages or node modules. You can also use the NPM as a build tool, which I highly discourage doing unless until you have a very small and isolated app. Because if you're going to use the package.json or NPM as a build tool, the number of options you are having is going to be limited. I would rather recommend using a module like Grunt or Gull or Broccoli to do this. So we're going to talk about those also a bit later. So here, if you are going to use it as a build tool, you can say npm start, that starts your particular server or service. Npm test, which will help you test the application. Npm stop, which will actually stop the application. So this is like a process of building things. You can also create a process like npm lint, where, as you have seen earlier, you can run a JS hint or a code quality tool. And JS hint, if you guys do not already know, is a code quality tool written to analyze the standards and coding conventions of JavaScript to avoid bugs and defects. So similarly, you can build all your tools in the npm scripts and work with it. You can also use the pre and post hooks available. Imagine you want to, when your module gets installed, you want to run a post install script, check if everything is working fine or certain requirements are met. Or before the module is installed, you want to check a particular version of Node or a particular other package is installed or not. Things like that, you can use the pre and post hook to do that. Generally, we use the post install script a lot for doing post installation. So you have module A and module B. Module B is dependent on module A. So we never explicitly load module B. Rather, once module A is installed, in post-install script of module A, we load module B. We're going to look at that, and I'll show you a couple of places when we're doing mean.js or the mean stack development where this command is highly helpful. So the following package.json runs pre-lint first, and then lint, and then post-lint. This is how the three steps go. This can be done for any task, test, pre-test, and post-test, and so on. The condition is that you can look at the word lint, pre and post. That's the only catch here. Also, you can pass arguments to your scripts. So you can also pass arguments to underlying commands in the script using the hyphen hyphen operator. Kapil had a question. He says, is hooks part of scripts? Yes, hooks are part of scripts. So now you can do run ice cream minus minus vanilla.js. So this vanilla.js will get passed as an argument to the sum command. So you can actually do this npm run and the name of the script, excuse me, and then you can pass in an argument. So this argument can be passed to this. So as I told you, right, when we are working with the mean stack, when we have our own package.json for setting up the base package, then we are going to use these commands for building the application. Also, we can, to create a module or package for use, you can consider the following example. Function hello returns hello world. Module.export say hello. Say message is hello. Now when you require the dot slash file, you can say say dot say hello. Now this would execute the hello function in message.js. We discussed about this yesterday. In each module, the module free variable is a reference to the object representing the current module, that is the word say. Assigning your function or object to a variable under the module.exports make the function or object available to others. Also, you could have as many functions in the message.js, each having corresponding variable to have a corresponding variable in module.exports. You can do it that way also. Today when we are building the calculator function, we are going to attach four methods to the module.exports. So you can use that to work with the application as well. Okay, so I will show how to run multiple arguments when you're running this script a bit later. Because as I mentioned, we will rarely use this, but when we get there, I'll show you how to use it. Okay. Loading files and modules. So let's pause the presentation for now and let's go back and do some hands-on work so that you guys can get an idea of where we are headed to. I have created another folder called as session 2. Now I'm going to create another folder inside called as example 1. So this is session 2, example 1. So the first thing, whenever we are going to work with a node project, you guys can follow along with me on this. So you guys can, yesterday if you did remember, we created the session 1 folder. You can create the session 2 folder. And then inside that you can create a folder called as example 1. In the example one folder, open a terminal or prompt based on your operating system, and then we'll work together on this one. So once you have the in the example one folder, right, you open the command one, you will be starting off a new node project. From now on, whenever I say creating a new node project, it means running npm init. So now you know what to do with these properties. So whatever, when you run npm init in your system, it's going to ask you the example version, sorry, the name of the project. So we're going to say example one, or whichever you are comfortable with. I'm just going to give the version as 0.1.0, a description as a file reader app. So basically we are going to read files from here. And the entry point of the application is going to be index.js. We are not going to have any test command, no GitHub repository, no keywords, no author information, the default license, or you can use the MIT, then click yes. This will take care of generating our package.json. This is a quick and fast way of scaffolding a new node project. I highly recommend doing an npm init before you start off a new node project. Next, we're going to create a new file called as index.js, right? So since index.js is going to be our starting point to the application, we're going to create a file called as index.js. As of now, I'm going to close the package.json since we don't need anything from it. In this particular example, what we are going to do is that we're going to use Node.js core module named FS. Okay, so one way is I can tell you how to do it, what is available right now. But the actual way is that whenever you are planning to use any node modules, I highly recommend you going or directly searching node API in the name of the module, FS. This will take you to the documentation where it will consist of all the information for the FS module. The FS module here says it has quite a few methods. You see that every single method has two states, one non-asynchronous, that is non-blocking, another one is blocking. Anything which has an extension called a sync will run in a blocking way or the traditional way. Anything which does not have the word sync, it does not work the traditional way. So you can see the list of properties that are available here. For the first example, we are going to look at API called as fs.readfile. So if you go halfway down the documentation, you will go to this particular section called as fs.readfile. So here, they have provided a quick example of how you can use it, right? Excuse me. So the property is pretty simple. The first argument is the name of the file you would like to read. The second argument, generally the last argument of your any method in Node.js will consist of the callback. Anything from, if there are n arguments, 0 to n minus 1 arguments will consist of all the options, and the nth argument will consist of the callback. That is the understanding in any traditional node application that is written. Also, one more convention that follows is that if any callback is available, there are always two arguments or at least one argument, where the first argument will always be the error. If there is any error, that is always the first argument. If you in future are designing a node module by yourself, you should always keep this thing in mind that 0 to n minus 1 arguments in your function should be the options, and the nth argument should be the callback function. And the callback function, when you invoke it from your application, should have the error as the first argument. If you have an error, you send that object. So in this scenario, you say callback of null, comma, the data. Then the user would check if error, throw error. If it is null, it does not execute, but rather console.log data. So this is the convention when working with node applications. So we are going to take a look at the API, fs.readfile. So since this is a core module of Node.js, we're going to say var fs equal to require fs. It automatically loads it up. Next, what we are going to do is that in the current folder, we have this package.json. Just for fun, we're going to read that file and print its contents in the console. So the way you do it is fs.readfile, and then the argument .package.json. Now you see here fs.read, find the first argument is this. The second argument is the callback which we are going to write. So that is going to be comma function err comma data, or you can also call it contents. Contents of the file. Now I can check if err throw, is it new? Can directly use throw. Else, that means there is no error, we say console.log contents. So this is how typically you read file contents of a file. I'm going to clear my console. Now I run node index.js and then it is going to print. What happened here? It just printed the buffer. It just took the file, read the contents of it and printed. But we want, this is English for us, or in the computer language, this is UTF-8 encoded text that we see here. So the way you do it is that you pass the second argument to the fs.read file method called as UTF-8. Now when I run node index.js, it's going to read the file with UTF-8 encoding and print the contents of it. So this should give you an idea of how to interact with the package.json, the contents of it, and then print the values here. So just for fun, what I'm going to do is that I'm going to misspell the file name, and let's see what happens with the error. So now I have misspelled the file name. I'm going to clear the console, then run the same command, and then you say that it throws a new error. ENOENT, open dot this thing. There's an error at this location. So generally messages like this always occur. It gives you the line number where all this is happening. Index.js line 7, that is pretty much where that is thrown. So you can copy this message if you don't understand what is happening. You can go to Google and then just paste it there. Because debugging this, I might not be there always. So the best thing to do is that take the error message and you hit it, you'll get this thing. Node.js cannot open files, error enoids, pad, path to file. So it's pretty clear that the open method instead of the start method is used, and then there is some issue. So it says path specified with the dots are relative and so on. So you can read through the whole process and, you know, do stuff with it. That's another way of debugging your example. Since we already know what the issue is, I'm going to revert back. So next thing what we are going to look at is another node module called as, okay, sorry, we, this the first example which you have seen here is reading a file asynchronously. So to prove that, I say console.log, another independent operation. Okay, now when I run this, you'll see another independent operation and then you'll see the example one. Because printing the second operation is not dependent on the contents of this thing. If I have to do something like this here, this will throw an error because my package was never defined, of course, for obvious reasons, but you can, you know, you understand this point, right? So that means that this whole process is pushed into the event loop. And then this gets pushed into the event loop. This callback gets fired only after this process is completed. So this way, this whole process is non-blocking. So as per Ryan Dahl, when he was trying to upload the image to Flickr, he noticed this whole thing that, you know, once the, till the image upload is over, nothing can be happened in parallel. So for instance, like for example, I'm going to comment out this piece, then I'm going to write something called as var contents equal to fs.readFileSync. Sync stands for synchronous. Say .package.json, comma, UTF-8. Now, I say console.log, I'm going to copy this thing, var my package equal to json.parse of contents, and then console.log, I'm going to run it as my package.me. Now if I go back to the terminal, clear it, I'm going to move my terminal to the top or a place where you can see it. Okay, I hope this is fine. And then I'm going to run node index.js. You see here, it says example one, another independent operation runs after. So this is our traditional way of coding where we wait on all the IO operations. Using this very syntax called as fs.read file instead of read file sync. This whole thing works the same way. So this is how you make sure that in Node.js things run asynchronously. You guys have any questions on this? You guys can actually try this out. This is again present in the documentation. If you scroll down a bit below fs.readfile, you'll have read file sync. Synchronous version of fs.readfile returns the contents of the file name. If the encoding option is specified, then this function returns a string, otherwise it returns a buffer. Pretty much standard. So you can see that every single file operation method in Node.js has these two flavors. Any I/O operation related API method will have two flavors. One, the asynchronous way, two, the synchronous way. There are some times where you might need to do things synchronously still. So for those reasons, you can use this. So this is how typically we actually do a file reading or file processing in Node.js. So if I keep everything here and run this, you know that example one, okay, let me put a message called as async sync. So first the sync message runs, another independent operation runs, and then the async runs. So async is pretty much independent of the order of flow. Things happen when they are supposed to happen. This is how you can defer a request, right? The next thing we're going to look at is something called as global modules. So all the modules we have written so far are local modules which are available locally to your application, either inside your node modules or loaded along with your file system. So if you guys go to npmjs.com and then you can search for a module named uncss. So if you have done a bit of web development in your career, so you know that there are huge number of web pages and every single web page consists of a lot of CSS which it does not use. So you have a version, your app is of version 1, then it moves to version 2. A lot of styles which are in version 1 which goes to version 2, people are scared to remove because they don't know where and all it is being used. So for that very reason, people have come up with a module called as uncss. This removes unused CSS styles in your web page. Okay, this can be used as a command line as well as you can use it with Node.js. First, I'm going to show you how to use this with command line and install it using minus g flag. So for testing purposes, I don't know which page can we go to. We can go to the site called as getbootstrap.com. Bootstrap is another front-end development framework. If you did not already know, it's responsive and it's quite heavily used by the web today. Under the Getting Started section, Getting Started page, you'll see the examples on the right-hand side. When you click on examples, it will take you to a page here. Now, this is the sample template with which you can use. Generally, people come here, either right-click, inspect element, I'm going to push it back into my dev tools. And then I'll click on the nav bar and right click copy, and then I get the whole HTML and I start using it. But let us say that you're using only this much of a template, but you're loading the entire bootstrap.css file. So if I click here, it has the entire bootstrap.min.css file inside it. I'm not going to use print classes. I'm not going to use some other specific classes called as hidden MD, hidden LG, and so on, because I'm not using these things. I want to remove all the unwanted CSS. Or if I click on audits in my Chrome developer tools and click on run audit on present state, if you see here, it does an analysis of network utilization and web page performance and click on run. And it comes back saying that remove unused CSS rules. There are 1338 unused CSS rules on this page, which is affecting the page size. So we now know that unused CSS causes the unwanted page size. So if only we have a node module which takes care of handling this. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to copy this link for now, or I'll rather go back to uncss, and then I'm going to take this command called as npm install -g uncss. I'll go back to my terminal. Do remember that whenever you are running any command with -g, you can be at any location on your terminal or command prompt while running it, because this module is not going to be installed locally on that folder, but rather globally. So when I run npm install -g uncss, it's going to install this globally. So let me show you what happens. It downloaded all the modules to it. So I'm going to press Ctrl L. Now, when I run uncss directly in the command prompt, it is going to execute that module. Now this becomes a command line tool for us. Uncss and no arguments should typically print all the values here. I don't know why it's stuck. Or you can run uncss minus V. So minus capital V. Yeah. Uncss minus capital V will give you the version of this thing. As you can see, let me show you again. I am going to uninstall this module, npm uninstall -g. Remember, if you install a module globally, you have to uninstall the module globally as well. Now it is gone. Now when I run uncss minus capital V, it is saying command not found uncss, because the command doesn't exist. If I go ahead and install it, it becomes a command line tool, and we are going to look at the source code of uncss, not the logic part of it, but the structure part of it. Now it installs everything. As you can see, the location where it is mapped to here, user local bin uncss is the place where the installer is present. All the dependency files are present inside user local lib node modules folder uncss bin uncss. If you are a Windows machine user, you will probably have this inside roaming slash data for your user account. Inside the node underscore modules folder is the source code which resides, whereas the executable uncss resides inside the bin folder. So this is what that statement means. Now, if you come back to the documentation and scroll down a bit, it says that the way you can do it is uncss options and file or the URL where you want to save the file to. So I'm going to create another folder in my session 2 called as example 2. CD into that folder. So let us say that I want to save all the used styles for this particular page, getbootstrap.com example slash starter template. All I need to do is that uncss, name of the page where I want to do it, a right arrow mark and say used, or probably can call it my styles dot css. And hit return. This will go download the page, analyze for all the conditions which are available, and create a file called as mystyle.css, which is consisting of only the used styles here. If I go back, open example 2, you should see that mystyles.css is created. So how was it created? Using this uncss command and then saving the values. So it identified only the list of classes which I am using. So typically this is around 500 lines of code. Whereas if I come back here to my source in the developer tools and click on this little squiggly brace, it's around a 7,000 lines application. And then there is no class called as print. If I copy this at the rate media print and search, oops, maybe it's being used somewhere, sorry. There's one more hidden hyphen LG. So this class which we have seen there is not available here. As you can see here, this is not being used here, so all the unwanted styles are ripped off. So when you are migrating your application from phase 1 to phase 2 and you want to do this, you can easily do this, you know, removing all the unwanted styles. So since this is a global package, you can use the command line tools to do it, like uncss space the name of this thing. So this is more of, if there is only one developer running in your project and then who is managing everything, this would be easy. Another option in Node.js is that you can take this module and run from within Node.js as well. as like this. So you say var uncss, require uncss. This is how we require a module. Then var files, you can specify a list of URLs that needs to run through this, okay, which is my array of HTML files. In our scenario, this is going to be only the name of the website from which we are going to do this. UnCSS also provides a list of options where you can configure it to download, exclude, include, manage, and do everything. You can ask it to ignore. You can ask it to ignore a given selector. Do not remove given selectors from this thing, even though it is not being used. Specify the media paths. Process additional media queries than what is specified. Relative path where the CSS files are located. Style sheets. Ignore style sheets, raw content, pass in the raw string of CSS if you are using it. For example, you come here, I'm going to press this thing again. If you want to pass this whole raw CSS to command line, you can use the raw flag where it takes in the string and then gives you the unwanted CSS. A timeout in case if there is a JavaScript evaluation to apply your styles, which you'll understand a bit later. HTML root, the absolute part, and a configuration file which mentions all these things. Something like this. Sometimes when you're working with node modules, it is always good to check their GitHub repositories. Inside the GitHub repositories, sometimes you'll find a folder called as examples, where some of the examples might have already been written. In this case, we do not have one. So you can go back, and then we'll see here how to set this up using Node.js. I'm going to copy this thing, go back to my example 2 folder, create a file called as index.js and save that. Now, var uncss is equal to require uncss. This module is now loaded globally, and then your node module checks for it, not from the local folder, but from the global folder and then load it. Under var files, I'm going to say this very link. And then I'm not going to pass in any options. I'm going to call the uncss function, passing in the list of files and output. I say if error, throw error. Else you can use this, because since throw works like this, it will take care of doing it. Okay, so now when I go back to the terminal and run node index.js, it should have loaded this generally from the global folder. One second, let me see if I'm missing anything. So Vasudev, you asked the question, what does global mean in this context? Global means the path where we have installed this, that is which uncss, this path is the global path. So this is what I meant when I say global. But my understanding is that if you have this installed globally, it's going to work without that. Sorry, looks like it is not. Maybe we need to run npm install uncss. Minus minus save, that is to install it locally. Could it have been on a network instead? I don't think so. If it is on a network, it would work. No, I don't think so. If it is on a network, it would work. It needs to be on the same PC as the program you're running on. As far as I know, I have never tried it out, but that's a good experiment. We can check it out and see how it works. So this is installed locally. Oops. Now the same process happens from command line, node index.js, and then it goes, gets it. And now we are printing the list of styles into our command prompt. That's what we did here. So we said uncss, files, error, output. If error, throw error, else console.log output. Okay? So with this, you can see how easy it is to integrate a node module and start working with it. So you guys have any questions on this? How global modules work and how local modules work? What did we change to eliminate the initial error? I installed the node module locally. So when you install the node module locally, this require uncss is looking up the local chain and then loading it. So far I have never used a minus g module or a global module into local something like this. But there is always possibility you can do that. As you can see inside your local module also, the bin folder has been created with the uncss commands. So you can take a look at this at your leisure. This is all pure JavaScript which you see here. No other language, how uncss works. Using the process object, using the options, whatever you have passed. When you run uncss in your command prompt, uncss, and then, yep, I think so this should print the list of things here. I don't think so they have, if there is no argument or length, whatever. So this will generally print out the list of options which is available here. Great. So you can go through the documentation. Most of the node modules are very well documented, so you can get a feel of it quite easily. So generally, if you're looking for examples, right, I'll probably show you where you can find some examples. I think Express has their example folder, if I'm not wrong. Let me quickly check. So you can generally go to the package in the npmjs.com, click on the link. Yeah, see here, generally you will find this folder like examples in the GitHub repo. When you click on it, you'll have a bunch of examples that they have written using this. MVC, multipart, Jade, Hello World application, and when you click on it, you'll have the source code for it. So pretty much what we're going to take a look a bit later on as well. So there are quite a few node modules coming up these days. You can see what is the speed at which things are happening. There are around 143,000 packages on NPM as of today. Around, I don't know, it's a very good number of downloads in the last day, last week, and imagine the downloads in the last month. You see the list of modules which are available there. We'll talk about a bit about Browserify later on. Grunt CLI we're going to take a look at today. The Karma is a test runner for JavaScript code. You are already using the NPM package manager. Gulp, Grunt, Gover, Less, a simple lightweight HTTPD, network daemon tools to collect metrics, a forever tool, and so on. So you can see a list of packages that are there on NPM. So NPM has a list of configurations. So I'm going to close this and say NPM config. So in your corporate networks, if you are using this for your office purposes or running under a firewall, you might need to set a few configs in your application. So you can use the syntax called as npm config set whatever key is the value, or npm get is the key. So for example, you want to see what are the things which are configurable here, go to run npm config list. We have a user agent which is configured, the bin location, the command, the configs. Generally, we have this npm config for registry. npm config get registry. It will return the URL of the registry where you are using. So sometimes in the corporate, HTTPS URL might not be allowed. So you can update this value saying npm config set registry to some other registry which is approved by your company, or you can actually use the HTTP version of it to download your assets. Now when I say npm get registry, it uses the HTTP version instead of the HTTPS version. Also this URL can be replaced with npm repositories out there. So a few days ago I have been working with a package, npm package called as a private npm, I forgot the name, it's called way too many modules to remember. It starts with NPM. Synopia, yeah, sorry, it's called as Synopia, pmjs.com, and then it's a module called as Synopia, S-Y-N-O-P-I-A. I'm sorry for the Googling. Yeah, S-I-N-O-P-I-A. So if you want, for your organization, you can implement your own private NPM repository server. That's a very nice point, Kapil. Kapil thinks that they should start categorizing the packages on NPM repo. Trust me, there are so many packages out there which are practically aimless. There is no easy way to categorize these things. The only way you can find them is using the keywords. So the keywords which I typed did not match anything. I said private modules. There are so many packages out there which use this private modules. But yeah, anyways, you just need to remember it. As of now, I don't think so. I have a method which I can give you that tells you where to find what. You see me, right, practically Googling everything here and there. Anyway, back to the requirement here. If your organization is not willing to check in packages into NPM repository, you can create your own private repository manager called a Synopia. Okay, so here you can find a lot of private packages which you create for your organization hosted, which never goes to the public repository. This was a solution available before NPM launched the private repositories, which was probably 2-3 weeks ago. Before that, I used to use NPM for corporates, which I used to consult for doing private repository. It is one of the most safest ways of accessing it. You can control the application access, the usage, who can check in or create a new package, and so on. So if you are interested, you can go through the Synopia for your organization. But now NPM has created its own paid version of private modules. You can see the link on top, NPM private modules, where you can create your own private modules by, you know, paying amount, and then you get your own username, and using that username you can create your own project in NPM. So that's pretty much, you can try it out, but I like the servers. There are still companies which are out there which are using their own private version of NPM. All the commands would still remain same, except the registry URL will be pointing to your server. http://10.188.12.1/my-registry instead of the public registry. So now any NPM install, NPM updates happen, go through this server, and this server decides whether the package is safe or not for your company and whether that package should be downloaded or not. You can approve or reject or do anything. This is pretty good. You should definitely check this out in case you're considering writing your own NPM packages for your organization. So NPM config at a high level can set properties like these to work with it. You can read through the documentation of the various properties, set, get, list, and so on. Yep, that is about NPM registry. As and when we go along with it, you can do that. So for the people who do not have a GitHub account, we'll spend 5 to 10 minutes in setting up the GitHub and NPM account. You guys can go to github.com. When you go to github.com, you can pick a username by clicking sign up. Give a name, give an email address, give a password, and create an account. If you're not able to do it during the session, you can do it later on also. But for the people who already have a GitHub account, you guys can directly sign in. Once you sign in, you can see a list of your feed, if you have any. Once you go to your github.com/your username, that is where you can see your status, commits, check-in, the organizations you are part of, and so on. That is step one. We need a GitHub repository to do all these things. The next is to create a NPM account. You can go to npmjs.com. On the top right-hand corner, you'll have something called as sign up or login. If you do not have an account, click on sign up. You'll be asked to give a username. There is no hard and fast rule of having your GitHub account as your username, but I generally use it that way. My GitHub account username is same as my NPM username as well. So I get the, and that will be easy for me to remember most of the things, because you know how many things we need to remember in today's authentication world. So if you are, you can actually come here, click on create an account, give a username, give a password, give a verified password and email address. The only condition is that it should be in lowercase and it should composed of URL safe characters. So 9 out of 10 times your GitHub user account will work, GitHub user ID will work, account name will work here. I'm going to give you like 3 minutes to set up a NPM account. probably you might get an activation mail. If you click on it, it gets activated. I don't remember, I done it quite a long time back. So I'm going to give you 3 minutes to set up your NPM account. So I had an interesting conversation here. So the question was, why do you need an NPM account? So you need an NPM account so that you can publish your own packages. That was the primary understanding. And you can share these packages with others to use it. Remember, we installed the chalk package. We installed the uncss package. Somebody else has created that with their own username and account and pushed it to the NPM repository, and then you can start using it. So that is why we primarily need an NPM account. So I'm assuming people who wanted to do the hands-on have already created an account. After you have done it, you can click on login. Once you log in, you'll be taken to your home page, which shows the list of packages which you have pushed into GitHub. I've done quite a few work in the last few days, but I'm not actively developing these days on NPM. Written quite a few modules. So now this is your NPM account. Right. So now, as I discussed earlier, we are going to create a calculator app. Not rocket science, nothing great, but you'll get a feel of what we are trying to do with the node module, and we're going to push it to the NPM repository. So first, let us focus on the business logic. Then I'll show you tips and tricks on how you can easily push modules to NPM this thing. We're going to deal a bit about manually doing it, a bit about the tooling system available out there. Okay? So if you guys are interested, you can create a third folder called as example 3. In the example 3, we are going to create a calculator app, a module which is going to have a calculator, add, subtract, delete, and multiply. So the convention states that whenever you want to create a new node module, we're going to start off with npm init. Here I'm going to call it a calc app. 0.1.0 is the version. The description says a test calc app. Entry point is index.js. The test command is nothing for now. GitHub repository, I'll leave it empty for now. Keywords, calculator, add, subtract, multiply, divide, author, I'll give my name, a license, MIT, I just want to keep it open source, yes. So this will take care of creating my package.json file. Next, I'm going to create another file called as index.js. Pretty much standard. I'm going to create another file called as calculator.js. So the idea is that now I'm going to create a module in my local project called as calculator.js. This particular module is a utility for my application, which consists of four methods, add, subtract, multiply, and divide, which is going to be used by my main application file, index.js. Okay, so let us create a namespace called as cal. Okay, it's up to you how you would like to design this. I'm going to create a JavaScript object notation, and then, an object notation, and then I'm going to create four methods inside it, like this. We're going to call it A plus B, and then I'm going to say return A plus B. Method called as sub, mul, and div. Subtraction A minus B, multiplication A into B, division A slash B. Simple. This is my module. Now I say module.exports equal to calc. I'm going to export the whole module as it is. You can also create a namespace inside the main application.calc as calc, as we have seen yesterday, to do this. So first I'll show you this approach of how things work, and then we're going to look at the other approach of how things work. Okay? So module.exports calc. In my index.js, I'm going to create a method called as calc equal to require .slash calculator.js. Now, var a equal to 10, var b equal to 20, var c equal to calc.add of A, B. I want to say console.log C. Right? So this is pretty much accessing the module. Nothing great we have done so far. Now if I go back to my command line, clear the console and run node index.js, it's going to say sum equal to 30. Pretty simple, whatever we have done. If you would like to namespace the export, as in like dot calc equal to calc, I'll make it like this, equal to calc. Now, you cannot directly access calc here. You should say calc.calc.add. Because this variable is mapped to this local variable, which is now storing the entire object. To get the value of the entire object's add method, we're going to actually use the calc.calc.add. If I run this, now the sum will be 30 because of this. To make the module look a bit elegant, I generally do not prefer adding a namespace to the export. So this is one way of, what do you call, setting this up. So let's say that you have built your own library here, your own library or list of functions, which you think somebody else also can be used, it can be used for somebody else also pretty helpful, like the UnCSS module, like the chalk module, where all your teammate has to do is run npm install calc, and he gets the calculator module locally, and then he can directly start using it in his application, which will be present in his node modules folder. So this is the whole process of setting up the npm account that, you know, we are going to create a node module and push it into the application. So the manual way of doing it. So if you go back to your terminal slash prompt, we are going to run a command called as npm add user. So when you click on npm add user, it will ask you to enter the username. The password, what you have created. So while typing, it will be disabled. So what is the email address with which you have created the account? That's it. Now my NPM account is set up. So I highly recommend you guys doing this if you are following along with me to publish a node module. Great. So everybody has created their npm account. Whoever wants to follow along has run the npm add user and has logged into their npm account. I hope everybody has done that, right? So now our process is that we want to push this module to the public npm repository, where your teammates, your friends, or somebody who would like to access it will download it and use it the same way how we are doing with other node modules, right? So for us to do this particular process, so first and foremost, or the most important thing, is that the name in the package.json should be unique. Okay? No package, two packages with the same name should not exist in the npm registry. So you will find very weird names in the npm packages as you see here. So if I go to npmjs.com, this is the easiest way which I found to check. I click on any package. As you see, the URL gets updated saying that npmjs.com/package/express. Now, if I paste my package name, which I have given here, that is calc app, and hit enter, if it opens up a page, that means it exists. That package exists and you cannot do a push. But if that page does not exist, it means that it is available for us to use. So, this is one easy way to check if your package name is available or not. It is very surprising to see that people didn't use the namespace calc app. That's very surprising. So this is how we actually configure it and then push it to the npm repository. But to make sure that you guys understand the modern tooling system and modern things which come up with these things, I don't want to use the manual process of pushing something to the repository. But pushing something to the repository is as easy as running two commands. Command one, npm add user, which is a one-time command which you'll be running to set up the npm in your local machine. Command two is the folder from which you're going to run this, right? Calc app. Okay. Now I'm going to run npm publish and hit enter. It says invalid name calcap. Okay, should be small. Oh, maybe that's why it's not available. Let's try all small models. Yeah. Oh yeah, calcap will be yours. So nobody has done this yet. So we are going to take advantage of that. The first mistake, if you guys did not understand, the mistake I did is that I created the name of the package.json with camel case. The name of the package.json should always be in small letters. It's a mistake which I did. I fixed it by making it small letters, went back to the package location in the npm, and then accessed the same name, and it says not found. Calcap will be yours. So I'll go back to my terminal in the example 3 folder and run npm publish. Once I hit npm publish, Node will take care of all these modules and dump it into the repository. Now, if I refresh, magic is in front of your eyes. The calcap was published by me 2 minutes ago. Okay, now there is no GitHub link associated with this. So people cannot raise issues, track the bugs, or do anything with it. Okay, so no README file was found. Nothing has changed. Okay, so the next step is that let us assume our project is published. Now, by the way, if you guys run npm install calcap in your machines, you're going to get the source code. Just to quickly show you that, I'm going to create a new folder called as example 4. Okay, inside this I'm going to, okay, let me open a new terminal here. This is the example 4 folder. I say npm init. My app is going to call as test calc app. Oh, same mistake. I'm going to leave everything blank as it is. The package.json gets created. Now I run npm install calcap minus minus save. You see here, now it has downloaded the calcap repo. Remember the index.js file, the calculator.js file. This is not a valid, by the way, the very important point here is that this is not a valid package, this is not a valid module for you guys to consume it. Because the calculator.js, there's an index.js. Now, for instance, if I come here, say new file, and type index.js inside it, var cal equal to require calcap. Oops, I created this at the wrong location. Let me close off my existing file so that you guys are not confused with what's happening. I'm going to create a new file inside example 4 folder called as index.js. I'm going to say var calc app equal to require calc app. Okay, now there is no dot slash nothing. This is an installed module, so we're going to refer it like this. So remember, in example 3 folder where we created this, what happens when you run node index.js? The whole thing gets executed. So now this is probably going to throw an error, hopefully. When I say node index.js, it's going to execute the index.js file here, and then that's it. Nothing happens. We never expose the calculator.js file as a package to our application. Right? We rather expose the index.js file here. As you can see from here, it says main file is called as index.js. So when npm runs, when you do a require, in your application require calc app, this is the file which gets loaded. That is index.js. What happens when I invoke index.js? This function executes and the output is print in the page. Even though I did not write any console logs or anything, this one line executed the code which is present inside my module. Does everybody understood what the issue is here? Using a npm module is totally different from publishing your own npm module. That is the point I'm trying to make here. I'm going to give a minute so that you guys, if you have any questions, you can post it here. The next step is I'm going to show you how to expose the calculator itself, not the index.js file which you used for testing. Okay, I'm thinking there are no questions, so I'll go ahead. So now, going back to the example 3 folder, I'm going to close the example 4 for now. In the example 3 folder, we mentioned something called as main. So when you run require the name of the app, your node modules look for the main property of it and then load up that particular value into the require statement. Okay. So now what we are going to do is that we are going to change this to calculator.js. We are not going to use index.js anymore in our app. We just use index.js to test the application. Whereas our business or the meat lies in the calc folder, right? So either you can keep index.js, delete it, or probably move it to another folder called as examples and then ship it also. It's up to you. In the package.json, I have made this change and moved my application to calculator.js. Now, I would like to publish this. So, we were speaking about SEMver. SEMver is SEM versioning system. Two modules, I'm going to close the example 4 terminal. I'm going to keep the example 3 terminal open. Two modules, the same module cannot be pushed twice to the NPM with the same version. It does not make sense. If you are making an upgrade or making changes like what we have done here, this is a major change, right? So I'm going to put this under the, this is major version, this is minor version, and this is the patch version. That indicates this. So this is quite a big change. It is not something which is going to change the application itself, but rather a small change, but a significant change. So I'm going to make this change and increase the version of this thing. So to show what NPM does if I do not change the version, I'm going to run, after making changes to my source code, I'm going to run NPM publish. It's got a complaint saying that failed put on 403. It says that you cannot publish over the previously published version. If you need help, read this thing. Okay? Now, the point is that we're going to change it to 0.2.0. Now when I do npm publish, it's going to publish the new version. That is 0.2.0 version. Okay? Now, if I go back to the npm.js, refresh it, on the right hand side, you can see that probably it might take a minute. It might take a minute to load this up to 0.2.0 version. Okay, I'll probably try it one last time. No, it's not yet updated. So it might take some time for the updation, but I can go back to my example 4 folder. I'm going to close the example 3 folder. Inside the example 4 folder, there is package.json. This is a very, 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 very important point to be made here. Always mention the version of your dependency explicitly. While creating the dependencies, you can use latest. When you run npm install, at that moment, whichever is the latest version will get downloaded. But in your production applications or the applications which are trying to deploy this to, never, ever, ever use latest. Without your knowledge, the package owner might have upgraded it to something else which will make you crash the app. So always use the version of it. Now, I can change the version of my app to 0.2.0 because I have upgraded it. I go to the example 4 folder. Inside the example 4 folder, I'm going to run npm update. This is going to get the latest version of CalCap, which is 0.2.0. It says that CalCap was updated. Now, if I go to index.js, previously when we ran npm, when we ran node index.js in example 4 folder, it printed the output of the index file. Now, it should not. It is just a library right now. It is just a library which is exposing the calculator folder here. That is this. Now, what I can do is that I'm going to do the same example here. Instead of this, I'm going to say calc. Now when I run index.js, the sum is 30. You see this, now once pushing this app, calc app, to the public repository, your whole team can start utilizing the features and functionalities of these things. I'm going to give a 5 minutes break, or probably there's 8 minutes break. You guys can take a moment, go to the GitHub, check out what is there for this particular package, that is npmjs.com/calcap. I hope it should be updated by now. Yes, it's updated. Check out what is there. Since we did not associate any GitHub with it, you're not going to find any source code. because this is one way you can abstract the source code. But unfortunately, when somebody does npm install, they get the whole source code to them. So what you guys can do right now is that create a new project called as example 4, and then npm install calc app, and then run this as node index.js. So this calc app is something which we just created as our own module, and it should work fine. So I hope everybody at least got a concept or a grasp of what we are trying to achieve. We're trying to create our own node modules and push it into npm repository so that everybody can consume it. So today's open source world is pretty heavily driven. If you already would have seen the amount of contributions people are doing, putting stuff on the public repos, so that you don't spend time in creating or doing those mundane tasks. So one of the perfect examples is this library from the npm repo called as bcrypt. So bcrypt is a library for Node.js for doing or managing securities. So you want to safely create securities, you can use it. A lib to help you hash passwords. So you remember the process of creating a salt and the password and then managing it. So this is one library out there.